as we sing Everlasting God.
Strength will rise if we wait.
Morning, we thank you for being the God who rescues us, for being the God who loves us, God. And we just thank you this morning for just giving us a morning that we can worship you, God. And God, I just ask when Tom comes up here in a few minutes, God, that you just speak through him, God, and you just share the word that you have for us today, God. And God, I just ask all this in your son's name. Amen.
He is our Lord, he is our King forever and ever. Amen. Let the sea resound, let the heavens tell.
Before you now, praising your name, Lord.
stand as we sing, Holy is the Lord.
We stand and lift up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down in worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He. Together we sing, everyone sing. Holy is the Lord, God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord, God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. The earth.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we just come to you this morning, Lord, so thankful that you gave us such a beautiful day to worship. We pray, Lord, that each person here come to worship you, Heavenly Father. The message that Brother Tom is going to give to us this morning is going to come from his heart, and I feel in my heart that this comes directly from you, Heavenly Father. We just praise you and worship you. We come to this part of our service, Heavenly Father, brother, we give back to you, Heavenly Father. And we do it with an open heart, Heavenly Father. And we pray, Lord, that this minute that the Lord will just touch you, Lord. We ask this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen. Choir, that was beautiful. Jeff, I'm going to give you a moment to kind of work on our sound here a little bit. We've got a big rumble up here. I think it's probably coming in strong in our floor monitors or something. Dr. Holder is away on a faith walk retreat and will be back this evening. And if you have given any consideration about attending a faith walk retreat at some point in time, let me encourage you to do so, to stop thinking about it and sign up. It is a wonderful weekend. You will be loved on and encouraged. You'll come away from that weekend just very glad that you did. And I can tell you from my own personal experience attending, I didn't know what to expect. Went in thinking, what am I in for? And as a matter of fact, the day I left, I was thinking, man, if I thought I could get out of this and get away with it without making the friend of mine that had invited me so disappointed and angry, I probably would have, because I had plenty else that I could be doing that weekend. But I got over that pretty quickly. It is definitely a weekend worth the investment, and I would encourage you to prayerfully consider going whenever you can. They have them twice a year at Dry Creek, and I would just encourage you in that direction. I want to read this morning out of Ezekiel chapter 16, verses 1 through 15. It's an Old Testament passage, won't be very familiar with many of us, and you're going to listen to this passage or read it if you've read it already and think, and I've heard comments this morning, you can't pair this passage with the title, can't figure out where you're going to be going with this sermon. Well, that's okay, I don't either, so we're going to figure it out together. Just kidding, I know where we're going, but let's read it together in Ezekiel chapter 16, verses 1 through 15. Then another message came to me from the Lord. Son of man, confront Jerusalem with her detestable sins. Give her this message from the sovereign Lord. You are nothing but a Canaanite. Your father was an Amorite and your mother a Hittite. On the day that you were born, no one cared about you. Your umbilical cord was not cut, and you're never even washed or rubbed with salt and wrapped in a cloth. No one had the slightest interest in you. No one pitied you or cared for you. On that day that you were born, you were unwanted, and you were dumped in a field and left to die. But I came by and saw you there, helplessly kicking about in your own blood. As you lay there, I said, live. And I helped you to thrive like a plant in the field. You grew up and became a beautiful jewel. Your breast became full and your body developed, but you were still naked. And when I passed by again, I saw that you were old enough for love. So I wrapped my cloak around you to cover your nakedness, and I declared my marriage vows. I made a covenant with you, says the sovereign Lord, and you became mine. Then I bathed you and washed off your blood, and I rubbed fragrant oils into your skin. I gave you expensive clothing and fine linen and silk and beautifully embroidered and embroidered and sandals made of fine goatskin leather. I gave you lovely jewelry, bracelets, beautiful necklaces, a ring for your nose, earrings for your ears, and a lovely crown for your head. And so you were adorned with gold and silver. Your clothes were made of fine linen and were beautifully embroidered. You ate the finest foods, choice flour, honey, and olive oil. Oh, and you became more beautiful than ever. You looked like a queen. And so you were. Your fame soon spread throughout the world because of your beauty. I dressed you in my splendor and perfected your beauty, says the sovereign God. But you thought your fame and beauty were your own, so you gave yourself as a prostitute to every man who came along. Your beauty was theirs for the asking. Father, may your word have its way in our hearts this morning. Give us ears to hear what your spirit is saying. Give us willing spirits to be obedient to what you're calling us to do. Father, give us resolve and determination to bring honor and glory to you by being obedient in all that you ask. For it's in Christ's holy and glorious name that we ask. Amen. I wonder how many dog versus cat lovers we have among us this morning. If you're a dog lover, would you please indicate by raising your hand? Okay, a sprinkling of dog lovers. All right. What about cat lovers? Would you raise your hand? All right. There's a few, fewer. All right, a little bit of both. All right. Okay. Well, usually there's you're the exception, Barbara, but that's nothing unusual. Just kidding. But yeah, usually it's one or the other. Well, if you have dogs in your life and they're either inside or out, I know growing up we had a euphemism when it came to dogs. Whenever dogs would have an accident somewhere in the house and it was my responsibility to clean up after them, my mom or dad would say, the dog left a present for you. And we all knew what that meant, and it was my job to clean that up. But you know, if you ever have dogs out in your yard or out at the park, even if you don't care for dogs yourself, this may be a good reason why you don't care for dogs. It's because they leave those presents laying around from time to time. And have you ever had the pleasure of accidentally stepping in one of those presents? And yeah, it's not a pleasant experience. It's made better if you actually have shoes on, but not much. Well, yeah, and then what do you do after that? Whenever you've stepped in one of those presents, you typically, well, a friend of mine and I were, one of our members was having this discussion, and, you know, I'll, to protect the innocent, I will refrain from using his name, but his initials are J.R., and y'all know who that is? Well, he said he did that. He stepped in something, and well, you know, typically he did what all of us do. You wipe it off in the grass and do your very best. And, well, you know that's not going to get it if you have any tread left at all in your shoes. And so he kicked them off and left them there at the doorstep and went on inside. At least didn't bring it in and track it in the house and all that. We left them there for a few weeks and hoping the material would dry and flake off and whatever, at least air out. Well, his wife, Faye, which, you know, I'm not talking about her, so I'm not going to use her initials. She's innocent in all this, but said, so that way JR stays anonymous. But you're welcome, Justin. Got you out of wherever you are. But he decided he was going to slip those shoes on really quick and got in the car with his wife and I mean they weren't even out the driveway yet and Faye says, "Did you step in something?" And JR's response was, "No, well, not today." You like my JR impression? But she said, "Go change your shoes because you stepped in whatever it was. It's still with you, and change your shoes." So he changed his shoes, and everything was fine. And he went home later that evening and scrubbed his shoes clean, and they're fine now. So we're all grateful. Well, why in the world would I share this crazy, weird story? Now maybe you understand the graphic on the bulletin, if you've noticed, Soul Check and the tennis shoes. Well, what JR had to do was he had to take those shoes inside and scrub them clean and get them clean because the residue was still there and the odor was very apparent to everyone who was concerned, and anybody who could smell him coming and knew there was something wrong and it needed to be fixed. Well, this passage that I read out of Ezekiel is just one such of those passages where God is expressing to Israel his extreme disappointment in his people. He called them out and gave a graphic description of what no one in their right mind, no loving person would ever do to a baby. To cast them onto a field, not care about them, not even tend to any of their needs. It's a horrible thought. How dare anyone do such a thing? But yet God said that is how he found Israel in that condition. And he took pity on them and he loved them from first sight. And he tended to their needs. And he raised them and developed them into a nation and adorned them with the very best that was available. and spared nothing in lavishing these riches upon his people. And then the last verse that I read, verse 15 of this passage, we read Israel's response. We read the depth of Israel's gratitude is expressed quite succinctly. But you thought your fame and beauty were your own. You thought you accomplished this in your life. You thought you developed these riches and these possessions that you've gathered around yourself. You thought you earned these blessings that I showered upon you. You thought you were all that. And that you were your own. You forgot that I bought and paid for you and lavished this upon you out of my generosity and out of my love for you. And so you gave yourself as a prostitute to every man who came along. Your beauty was theirs for the asking. God says, what I pulled you out for, set you aside for, propped you up for, adorned you and decorated you, lavished my love on you. Kind of like whenever we decorate a house when company's coming or for the season that we're celebrating at the time, how we clean it up and we adorn it and decorate it and it's beautiful. It's a thing of beauty and pride, and we invite people over to come enjoy this. That's how God lavished upon his bride there. He poured it out on him, on her, without restriction. Everything he had, he put it all there. Because he loved her. And he wanted to present her to the world. Look, this is my bride. Kind of like we do when we invite people over to our homes. Come look, this is my home. Welcome, welcome. Let me entertain you. Let me tend to your needs and love on you through the comforts of my own home. That's what God was inviting the world to experience through Israel. Come, this is who I am. This is what I do for those I love and who love me. I lavish everything I have on them. Come, be a part of that. Instead, Israel saw her blessing and got used to it, got comfortable in it, and thought she deserved it. She did this. And so she felt like she could give it away to whomever she liked. And she squandered it around those who would have no appreciation for it. Well, today, fast forward many, many years, and we have Jesus Christ, who once again lavished upon us the very best that he had to offer. Everything he had to give, he gave to us. Once again, poured it all out on the cross, because we are all born with a sin nature. We are born to rebel against God. We were born out of a relationship with him, but he loves us still, and he sees us in that condition, and he says, I love you, and because I love you, I want to spend eternity with you. I want you to spend eternity with me, and I want to have that relationship with you. And so he poured out once again. Once and for all, through Jesus Christ, his own son, he poured it all out there at the cross. And so many of us have come across and recognized our sinful nature in light of a holy God and recognized our deserving of death and hell and separation from him because of our iniquities in us. And we've come to a point in our lives where we accepted Christ as our Savior. And we have accepted the gift of his death on the cross as the payment for our sins. And we live in that salvation. But others of us have not. Others of us haven't recognized the sin within us. And we still live in the penalty of our sin. But those of us who have dealt with our sin at the outset, many of us over time have gotten comfortable thinking that our situation is our own making. We acknowledge God. Sure we do. We know that he is the one who saved us, that we're sinners. We acknowledge that. It's obvious to us. We know what we've done. But there's a certain amount of acceptable sin in our lives that we've grown comfortable with, and we live with it, thinking it's okay, nobody really notices. And if it ever does get noticeable, we wipe it off in the grass like everybody else and walk around with stink in our soul because we're comfortable living with sin, unconfessed, unrepented of sin in our lives. But you thought your fame and beauty were your own, so you gave yourself as a prostitute to every man who came along. Your beauty was theirs for the asking. Matthew 23:25, Jesus is talking to religious leaders in the community. And he says this to them, "What sorrow awaits you, teachers of the religious law, and you Pharisees?" Essentially, he's calling them Sunday school teachers and preachers. "You hypocrites, for you were so careful to clean the outside of the cup and the dish, but inside you're filthy, full of greed and self-indulgence. You blind Pharisee, first wash the inside of the cup and the dish, and then the outside will become clean too. What sorrow awaits you, teachers of religious law, and you Pharisees, you hypocrites, for you were like whitewashed tombs, beautiful on the outside, but filled with on the inside with dead people's bones and all sorts of impurity. Outwardly, you look like righteous people, but inwardly, your hearts are filled with hypocrisy and lawlessness." Christ has forgiven us, but we hold on to those things in our lives that we see are so common with other folks, and we think we are acceptable, and we can live with this amount of sin in our lives and be okay because we compare ourselves with each other. But when we compare ourselves with Almighty God, we recognize pretty quickly that He is holy and He is perfect, and His standards of holiness and perfection have never changed. He demands holiness and perfection from us so much that He allowed His own Son to be crucified on that cross so that we could have that perfection in Jesus Christ. And yet we think that perfection that Jesus Christ pours out upon us, that forgiveness that He gives us, that victory that we can walk in, gives us a license to sin, to wink at sin in our lives when we know good and well this is unbecoming of a person who has been bought by the blood of Christ. We know good and well that this is a sin that Jesus Christ died for, and we're okay with that. It should grieve us in our hearts and our minds every time we revisit those sins in our lives. And they're different for all of us. Many of us struggle with the same sins. Many of us struggle with unique ones. It doesn't matter. God knows our hearts. God knows our struggles. And He loves us just the same. And His forgiveness is complete. But our job is to confess our sins to Him and to repent of our sins. Christ has done the work 2,000 years ago. I want to clarify something. I've heard all my life and continue to hear to this day, and I've said it myself, but I try to stop, that if we ask God to forgive us of our sins, when we're praying today as believers, really that confession of sin is an agreement with God. You see, God forgave us of our sins 2,000 years ago when Christ died on the cross. He paid for every sin I ever committed from the day I was born to the day that I die. Same for everybody in the entire world. They're all forgiven, period. We don't have to ask Him to forgive our sins. He already has. Our job now is to accept the gift that He has given us of forgiveness and to walk in that. And when we confess our sins to God in prayer today, which we certainly should do, it is our acknowledgement to God that, God, yes, this is another one. This is a sin you have already forgiven. Thank you for forgiving me. Thank you for dying on the cross for me. God, help me put this behind me and not go here again. As a dog returns to its vomit, so man returns to his folly. God, may I not return to this. Let me repent. Help me repent. Bring it to my attention. And He will. 1 John 1:9 says this, If we claim we have no sin, we are only fooling ourselves and not living in the truth. But if we confess our sins to him, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all wickedness. If we claim we have not sinned, we are calling God a liar and showing that his word has no place in our hearts. So many times we as believers, we know we struggle with sin, but we pretend we don't. We pretend we have it all right and all's okay. But 1 John 1:9 encourages us to confess those sins to our Lord and to enter into accountability relationships with one another. Because we don't have it all together. And we don't have it all right. I think there's probably nothing worse than coming across a situation where you thought you had something taken care of and it's not. By way of illustration, I have here in my pocket a little surprise that I got in the mail this week. And it's a debit receipt. Many of you know that I've recently been working with Christus Home Care, Christus Hospital, as a chaplain for hospice ministry. And there's a little bit of compensation that goes along with that. But they want to do it direct deposit into an account. And so this is a direct deposit receipt. And I was surprised when it came in and very excited that, oh, wow, okay, this will help on some things that we've got coming. And Jeff, is anybody up there to turn on this microphone? Nope. Okay. Well, all right. This one right here. All right. I haven't briefed John Paul on this. Surprise. John, you know, the excitement about unexpected money, you know, the thrill that you have in your heart, you think, oh, wow, this is great. This is going to help out some things. I wasn't expecting this. I want you to read the amount on this check here.
$0.00.
Thank you. Yes. Now, can you understand going from the thrill of, oh, wow, to, oh, really? It was just a cruel joke, I guess. I think they were checking to make sure the account was real. Why would I give them a false account? But anyway, the point is this. That is a minor disappointment. But imagine the disappointment that we face. Those of us who were trusting in our own good works, our own good deeds, our own niceness, whatever, popularity, riches, whatever we're depending on besides Christ to get us into heaven, to have that relationship with God, to say, oh, it's okay, you can come in. Imagine the disappointment whenever we open up that receipt. He opens the Lamb's Book of Life and no, this gave you a grand total of zero credit. It's Jesus and Jesus alone. But if we choose to pay for our sins ourselves, that's exactly what we're going to open up on that day. If we claim we have no sin, we're only fooling ourselves and not living the truth. But if we confess our sins to him, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all wickedness. If we claim we have not sinned, we are calling God a liar, showing that his word has no place in our hearts. We have to repent. And our life of repentance is not an effort to earn salvation. Because if we do, we're opening up that zero balance deposit. But instead, that repentance that we walk in, the life of obedience is out of gratitude for a God who took pity on us, who loved us unconditionally when we had no value to anybody else. He saw value in us because we were his. His to redeem, and he lavished that upon us. And so our walk today of repentance and not walking around with the stuff on our soul is out of gratitude and recognition of that supreme favor that he has done for us. Matthew 18:7-9 encourages us to do whatever it takes to root that sin out of our lives. It says this, and anyone who welcomes a little child like this on my behalf is welcoming me. But if he calls one of these little ones who trust in me to fall into sin, Oh, it would be better for you to leave a large millstone tied around your neck and that you be drowned in the depths of the sea. In other words, the sin in our lives that causes others to think that it's okay. No, not so much. Verse 7. What sorrow awaits the world because it tempts people to sin? Temptations are inevitable, but what sorrow awaits the person who does the tempting? So if your hand or your foot causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It's better that you enter into eternal life with only one hand or one foot than to be thrown into the eternal fire with both your hands and feet. And then if your eye causes you to sin, gouge it out and throw it away. It's better to enter eternal life with only one eye than to have two eyes and be thrown into hell. What Jesus is saying is, do whatever it takes to live in a right relationship with me. Do whatever it takes to live a life that honors the gift that I have given you. Do whatever it takes. For some of us, that means we cancel some subscriptions. Internet pornography is one of the number one problems in the church. And people say, I can't overcome it, I can't overcome it. Well, it's just as easy as a check to the internet service provider. It may not cure the disease, but it certainly takes the product out of the home. It certainly limits access. Accountability is an excellent form to help you overcome temptations that besiege you. Do whatever it takes. Humble ourselves is what God is expecting us to do. Humble ourselves before Him and before one another. Stop pretending that we have it all together, deceiving ourselves and pretending that it's all going to be okay, winking at sin and walking around with a pile of stink on the bottom of our soul. Romans 8:1 says, So now there is no condemnation for those who belong to Christ Jesus. And because you belong to Him, the power of the life-giving Spirit has freed you from the power of sin that leads to death. No condemnation for those who belong to Jesus Christ. Brothers and sisters, that is good news. Everything I've said is very true. We are sinners, and we tolerate sin. But it doesn't diminish the love that God has for each and every single one of us. Not one bit. But the consequences of us tolerating sin in our lives is astronomical. You know, investment advisors advise against you pulling out of your retirement fund early to do a loan or something, to pay something off, because it's going to cost you in the long run and you really don't have any idea how much it's going to cost you. Yes, I think that's similar to what we're experiencing whenever we tolerate sin. Does it send you to hell if you're a believer? No. Does it rob you of the power and the peace that Christ can give us through the power of the Holy Spirit? More than we realize. We are so comfortable. James 5:16 says, are any of you suffering hardships? You should pray. Are any of you happy? You should sing praises. Are any of you sick? You should call for the elders of the church to come and pray over you, anointing you with oil in the name of the Lord. Such a prayer offered in faith will heal the sick, and the Lord will make you well. If you have committed any sins, you will be forgiven. Confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The earnest prayer of a righteous person has great power and produces wonderful results. I would encourage you, if you don't have somebody in your life that would be a good accountability partner, that you would pray God to send you someone. You have to be careful with who you trust to be an accountability partner. They've got to be somebody that they're trustworthy. They're not going to go around and tell the world your business. But it's somebody that doesn't have judgment in their heart for you, but someone that accepts you for who you are and knows what you could be in Christ Jesus, can see that kind of potential, and is willing to do whatever it takes right along with you to help you get there and let you help them the same direction. Someone you can be honest with and upfront. You can have good days and bad days. That's an accountability partner, and that's what many of us need in our lives. They're hard to find. What in the world do I want you to do with this message? Well, if you have a connection card in your bulletin, there it is. It's all there. I have two options, really, each with their own consequences. If you'll look at that, I'm going to ask you to at least consider it. Your outline this morning is blank because I'm going to ask you to do some things with that, either in the time we have left, which isn't much, but this afternoon in your time with God. I would ask you to consider the answer to two questions. I have sin in my life that I have tolerated. I'm sorry, I just made that as an assumption on here that all of us are like that. If that doesn't apply to you, you need to read, what was it? First John 1:9. But that wasn't very fair, I'm sorry. I have sin in my life that I've tolerated, but I choose to do nothing about it, choose not to do anything about it at this time. And so I'm going to go home today the same as when I got here. Or you're going to go home today and you'll consider this some more, which these are all fair options. Or I'd like to talk about this further, please contact me. Now don't check that if you don't want to be contacted and have a frank discussion. One of the members of our ministry staff will contact you and we will have some frank discussions. Or your other option is, I've tolerated this for far too long and I'm ready not to just wipe it off and pretend it isn't there. I'm ready to confess those sins. Then that's what I want you to use that outline for. Write this out to God in a way that you understand. You keep this. I don't want it. You keep it. It's between you and God. You write down how you would understand it. There are other things in your life that you've tolerated that are stuck to your soul that you're holding on to or just can't shake. Write it down in a way that you would understand it. Confess these sins to Christ and repent. Commit to rooting out the remnants, which is doing whatever it takes to cast the sin away from you, to defeat this in your life. And then thirdly, I'm interested in having an accountability partner. And if you don't have one, check that box if you're interested. But notice, if you check that option, your name will be added to an accountability partner pool, and we'll attempt to help you connect with others looking for accountability partners. Now, this will only work if you turn in your connection card. So fill that out and turn in your connection card at the Connection Center. Be fine. Or you can leave it here on the altar if you'd like. It's up to you. But I pray that this morning we will make decisions and commitments to Christ and not be, as Israel was, counting our beauty as something that we earned and our position before God as something we deserve and something we can freely give away with no regard to our Savior. Let's stand together now as we come into this time where we make these decisions. I'll be here at the front to receive you, your connection card, or you want to pray, something on your mind, you come. Father, we just give this time to you now. May we just be your servants and submissive to your Spirit. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.